So you guys are the founders of Wink Health. You're here today at the Chronoplex, Dr. Chrono's offices. You're Chris.
We have Darwin.
Tell me a little bit about Wink Health and what you guys do.
Sure. So we are an online sleep clinic where you can get diagnosed and treated for sleep apnea, all from your home and all using digital technology.
Awesome. How big is the market for sleep apnea?
Sleep apnea is a really interesting market because it's actually, the market size right now is much smaller than the amount of people who actually have undiagnosed sleep apnea. So I think the numbers are around 5 to 7 million people currently treated for sleep apnea in the United States, but the number estimated that have sleep apnea is around 40 million. So it's around an 80-85% of people who have it don't know they have it. And that ends up being about 1 in 7 Americans.
So a really basic question for you guys. What is sleep apnea and what are you guys doing to prevent it?
So, sleep apnea is a condition in which you noticeably stop breathing when you're asleep. It's like periods in which you're not breathing or in which you have restricted airflow. You're not breathing that much. And there are consequences to that. You can actually measure how much blood oxygen is dipping, you know, using various instruments. And it's been shown to lead to things like Alzheimer's and cardiovascular disease. So the primary method of treatment is CPAP. You know, it's kind of like the Darth Vader mask. I mean, you look like Darth Vader, but you on the inside you feel super energetic and stuff once you're treated. So that is the primary method of treatment. But the major barrier to getting treated is diagnosis. That's what we found. Chris alluded earlier to the stat, 85% of people who have it don't know they have it. And that's one of the primary things we're working to solve right now, just educate people about the condition, that they have the condition, and also making the treatment flow much nicer. You know, in Silicon Valley here, we have really nice principles around UX, user experience and stuff. We're kind of taking all that stuff and popping it right into sleep medicine.
So very specifically, the way that we make diagnosis easier is the traditional way. There's really two ways. You can go to a clinic and you can sleep over, get wires attached to all of your body. Someone watches you while you sleep. In the last decade or so, that the machine has been reduced in size and you can bring it home now. Still, you have to put wires all over your body. So what we've built is a smartphone-based diagnostic tool that you just place your smartphone by your bedside within a couple feet. And it listens to the sounds you make while you sleep. And we have a series of algorithms that can deduce the meaning of those sounds. So if they're, if there's just normal snoring, or if the snoring is an apnea, if the snoring is a hypopnea, and we can count up those events throughout the night and come up with a result that is very similar to what you'd get if you went to a sleep lab.
It's actually very uncanny. Like, the most comfortable experience right now is this device that doctors send to your house. It's like, you know, you stuff things inside your nose, you wear a clip on your finger, it can be a little uncomfortable, some people can't sleep with that, and you have like a chest strap. That's actually the good user experience today. The worst user experience is you actually have to go to a clinic, you have to sleep there, and people actually will watch you on a video screen, and you're hooked up to all sorts of wires and stuff. So that's the worst experience. The incredible thing is that using sounds, we can actually do a little better than the portable device. We'll actually be able to catch medically important respiratory events that these heavy-duty instruments can't capture.
Right. Interesting. So you guys have a smartphone app, and you can download it. Is it? Do you have to pay for it? Is it free? So you're going after the consumer market and the doctor market. You're going after both of these. So for the patient side, so what do they do to download the app?
Yeah, so we have kind of two versions of the app. One is like a patient free app where you can download it, it will listen to your snoring, it will identify events like gasps, chokes, certain sounds. But then when you want to get into the real world of diagnosis, we have a version that kind of upgrades to a doctor version,
right?
Where the doctor can get the results that the patient recorded, review them, and the algorithms move up in their prediction of apnea, so they'll actually move from just saying this was a choke to this was a series of apneas. And the doctor can get that data and analyze it. and come back with a real prescription for treatment if appropriate.
Interesting. So when they hook you up with, I guess when you go to the sleep clinics, they hook you up with all of these electrodes and all of this, these devices. Would you say the future of sleep apnea would be you don't need all of that, you just need a simple smartphone where you guys take the recording, do a deep analysis on it? Is that where you see it's going?
Yeah.
I would say the vast majority of cases, like every now and then, someone's kind of like a very subtle case, and they're going to have to go undergo the entire diagnosis in a lab. But for the vast majority of cases, it won't be necessary. We'll do a better job than the portable device, and in so doing, we'll treat so many more people.
Yeah, we would. I mean, in all cases, we would recommend. We believe that our application could be a first line. There will be cases, as Darwin mentioned, maybe the patient doesn't snore. There's just going to be cases where it's difficult to find. And there's certain contraindications against portable monitoring in general. So certain patients, like say on oxygen therapy, would be recommended to go into the lab. So there's certain cases, but
right.
I think the vast majority.
And it's expensive to go to a sleep study. So it ranges between like thousands, right? Or
I think it's like $10,000 a night.
Wow.
If you go with Stanford, like they put you up at the Marriott near campus, and it's actually a lot of money. And you know that's the full price, I think, but copay, you still have a copay,
right? Which is also
$1,000,
right?
Yeah. But with this app, it's actually in some ways superior to that because you can do it many times. You know, it doesn't interfere with the way you sleep. There's nothing attached to your body, I mean, just imagine like you're taking this test over a week. And maybe you don't go for like CPAP treatment at first. Maybe you experiment with positional therapy. You have the device and you're experimenting with like a different pillow or a different sleeping position, or maybe your significant other poking you when, you know, he or she is annoyed that you're snoring so loudly.
Right.
No, not to imply that you always snore.
Right.
there's apnea without snoring as well. Although there are other breathing sounds often.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
So taking it on the doctor angle, what do you provide to them? So you guys are doing this free analysis for the patient, and say the patient downloads the app.
Yeah.
I mean, this is very good for patients who don't have the money or they don't have health insurance. This is a really great way for them to see what's going on if they want to take that next step.
Yeah.
On the doctor, and so say a doctor wants to recommend this to a patient, what's the whole workflow for them, and how do they enable the patients that they have in their patient pool?
So we've actually integrated into DrChrono, so you can order a sleep study directly for a patient, just a couple clicks. We pull out the information from the patient profile and basically create an order form. You sign it, go on, it's done. And the data comes back to you after the patient does the test. So it's actually rather simple.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So you guys integrated with DrChrono.
Yeah.
Where do you see yourselves going with the sleep apnea company? So I know that, I was reading online, it's a $1 billion industry.
Multi-billion dollar
yeah. industry. So what do you vision, what's the vision of where you're gonna take this company?
Yeah, I mean, we've talked about this a lot, and I mean, obviously we just wanna get the first steps like really good.
Yeah.
So we're like wholly focused on getting a high quality diagnostic tool out right now. But after that, the steps that we're interested in are, there's still a big barrier once someone gets diagnosed and is given treatment of adjusting to, staying with, and having the treatment adjust to them. So there traditionally hasn't been a good feedback loop between the practitioner and the patient in the early days of treatment, and oftentimes people will fall off, like the mask doesn't fit or it's uncomfortable in some way. And so CPAP compliance is this term that's often thrown around as this, like, it's a very bad, CPAP compliance is not very good. But there's been repeated studies that have shown if you have early support for people in the process, just someone there helping you out, compliance can go from 50% to 90%. So we're really interested in moving into that, is sort of software to support the early stages of treatment.
And once we're there, it's going to be even more exciting because, like, today, sleep clinics are trying to solve CPAP compliance. It's like a huge accomplishment if you get to 90%. We're interested in, once you achieve that, what else can you do? Can you get people off of treatment? Like, your hormones are working now since you have great sleep. You know, can you like figure out the particular cause of your condition and address that. Yeah. So I kind of think of treatment, like using current methods, as buying you time to figure it out.
Also, since we have a tool that can give constant feedback, if your apnea is getting better or worse, the person can iterate, do maybe more conservative treatments. So for example, CPAP is kind of a catch-all treatment for everybody, mm-hmm. but positional therapy, where you basically either learn to not sleep on your back, is a common, oftentimes people only have sleep apnea on their back.
Right.
So if someone can either, there's different ways you can get stop sleeping on your back, but if you can learn to stop sleeping on your back, you actually basically can solve your problem. And with a tool like ours, you can kind of test it over time and see if that's actually working. So it changes the idea from like this one-time treatment to this ongoing testing different things, and then eventually once you're like you found something that works, as Darwin mentioned, focusing on
doing that. Interesting. Yeah. So when you go into sleep studies and you go into a sleep study, they lay you on your back and they do the sleep study on your back. So that doesn't actually tell
it's
a realistic sleeping environment where someone's
we hear from people all the time. They say like, I can't believe they gave me that result because I was super uncomfortable and didn't. So it probably is an exaggerated result, probably. Yeah.
Interesting. Awesome, guys. Well,
yeah.
Is there anything else you'd like to tell me about Wink Health and what you guys do?
I would say like there's just a growing awareness of sleep apnea, its role in many things. For example, and the growing importance of sleep. I think a lot of conditions we're looking at, cardiovascular disease, even Alzheimer's.
Hmm.
I think one recent study showed that if you get on CPAP treatment, you can push back, you know, somewhat late in life, you can push back the onset of Alzheimer's by 10 years.
Yep.
There's like, it's the, getting this treated is so profound, both in the short term, you feel much better, and also in the long term, you know, you maintain quality of life for much longer.
Got it.
It's a takeaway.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys for being here.